And joining me now to discuss the situation, distinguished professor of international law at FAMU, Dr. Jeremy Levitt, a good friend of the program. Welcome again, Jeremy. Thanks for being with me tonight.
Good evening, Fred. Good evening.
Boy, so many places we can go with this. First off, let's start with the whole whistleblower concept, where people who see wrong as they perceive it and report it and are supposed to be protected from it, that doesn't seem to work so well anymore, does it?
It doesn't appear to be working. We have something called the Whistleblower Protection Act. It is to protect activity, the activity of individuals, and protect that activity. So if you see something that's wrong in the workplace and you report it and you're engaging in protected activity by reporting it, you're supposed to be protected from retaliation. And certainly in the case of Dr. Richard Bright, he was ringing the bell too loud, and officials in the White House and HHS really saw him as a troublemaker, particularly because of his opposition of using hydroxychloroquine as a treatment for the virus. And that really, I think, led to his ouster from BARDA.
So what was your takeaway from the testimony that you heard today, Doctor?
Yeah, I would say there's four major takeaways. I mean, one, which I think is probably not going to be reported in the mainstream press, is that the administration and the CDC have absolutely no plans to treat those minorities that are being disproportionately affected by COVID-19. He confirmed that with one of the questions from one of the congresspersons on the subcommittee. The others are that in January, he gave warnings about a shortage of supplies that was essentially serially ignored by HHS officials. In February, he attempted to stop the bypass of the vetting process for hydroxychloroquine. There was this push by the White House to make this the miracle drug. And so he objected to that. He called for the coordinated strategy of the coronavirus, and he wasn't taken seriously. Still, we don't have a comprehensive strategy. And then, he rejected the timeline being offered from 12 to 18 months for a vaccine. So he had about five major points, I think, that were critical. And basically, he warned us that if we don't get on top of this with a comprehensive strategy, there will be more infections and deaths, and it will reach the not just the hundreds of thousands, but perhaps even beyond that.
And I don't want to go away from that point without going back to what your first point there, that there is no plan in the administration that's geared to help the people that are most disproportionately affected by COVID-19, and that is people of color. We know that. That's a fact.
Yes. I mean, it's remarkable that we know that this virus is affecting us, those individuals with pre-existing conditions, people of color who often have pre-existing conditions. We are being affected at a rate, as well as Native Americans and Latinos and others. And there is no national strategy to affect this cohort and population. Imagine if there was a disease that affected only white people and only 10% of minorities were affected by it. Would the Trump administration be rushing out to find a solution to this? It just seems to me that they don't care about our suffering and the high death toll that we're experiencing at this current time.
And before I let you go, Doctor, a word more about the Whistleblower Act. Do you see any kind of a remedy to repair the protection for people who are whistleblowers who come forth and shine light on things that they believe are wrong?
Well, it depends on who you're whistleblowing on, right? If you're whistleblowing on the White House, any initiative that the president has taken stock of, you can probably call your career to an end. In his case, he's been moved from BARDA to the NIH. It's uncertain what his job is. He testified that he was under stress and doctor's orders. He's experienced hypertension. So they put an enormous amount of pressure on this scientist, one of the leading vaccine scientists in the world, quite frankly. And so I think it depends on who you're whistleblowing to. The president has shown a propensity to dismiss inspector generals who actually are the ones investigating whistleblower cases. So I'm not optimistic that this is going to change now or perhaps anytime in the future.
Get some of that Dr. Fauci kryptonite or whatever he's using to stick around. Dr. Jeremy Levitt, thank you so much. I appreciate always you joining me on the program. We'll speak to you again soon.
My pleasure. Thank you.
Have a good night. Be safe.